Great. Well, it's wonderful to be here. They often define, of course, a professor as somebody who talks in their student's sleep. But I'm looking at a lot of very wide-eyed and bright faces today, so well done for that. I wear a number of hats, as you'll see from this slide, not least in terms of my research at the University of Oxford, but also, as Nick has said, in the work I do with the Open Data Institute. I'll talk about that shortly. Great believer in the power of social media. It's my Twitter handle at Nigel_Shadbolt. And a lot of what I put out on that channel is essentially around examples and insights from and around the open data world. So now, one point I like to make, and I was speaking at a GIST conference just last week and making this point. Whenever there is a shift in our society, in our world, from what was previously a scarcity to what becomes an abundance, things change. And we know historically this was the case in the Agrarian Revolution, as we settled down in our urban settlements, grew food, abandoned a hunter-gatherer style lifestyle. The world changed. The world changed with the invention of movable print, the widespread dissemination of knowledge. What was previously scarce became abundant. It happened again in the Industrial Revolution with the availability of manufactured materials at scale that had not been seen before. And it's happening again in the Information Revolution. This is Tim's famous tweet from the Olympics, wonderful phrase. This is for everyone. This was the notion of giving the web standards to the world. The crucial difference in all of this is that previously, the goods, the stuff that we were making abundant, were typically rivalrous. That is, if I used it, you couldn't. If I consumed it, you didn't have it. Okay. This is famously not the case. Doesn't have to be the case, information and knowledge. And it's those consequences that I want to examine today. And also in the background, of course, the other thing that's become super abundant is computing power and the ability to record and lay down information. These are some of the famous plots you get in computer science. We're very seized with log-log plots. That is, the thing about a log-log plot like this, Moore's law on the left, which you've probably heard of, this refers to the density of transistors on a chip, roughly equated to computing power. The one on the right is called Kreider's law, log-log plot, which tells you how much information you can lay down on a particular area of whatever the device material is at the time to record information. They are genuinely exponential. They really do double, in this case, about every 15 months. It means that in my own field of AI research, I enjoy 1 million times more computing power than when I started. 1 million times means the world changes. So I always think it's worth thinking about the issue around abundance. It catches even the most professional and learned of individuals out. I was told sincerely by professors of AI that no computer could ever defeat the world's best chess champion. Well, there you go. Okay, never believe what anybody who's a professor of AI tells you about anything in the future, I suppose. Also, the other thing to try and find a log-log law in your world, okay, information professionals, you might get it named after you, okay? So find something that's roughly exponential and just point it out to people. It's a good tip. Right, here we go. Information density, information amounts. We all know this various forms of the tsunami diagram, from the amount of data that we upload to Facebook every day, to the number of tweets we make, to the amount of information that becomes available on our scientific instruments. The square kilometer array at the far right there will be generating more data than has typically been traveling across the entire internet. Extraordinary numbers. Numbers that actually require us to invent whole new terms. We get used to gigabytes, we move to terabytes, to petabytes, to exabytes. You might have heard of the zettabyte, but what about the yottabyte or the brontobyte? Okay, out we go. to 10 to the 27 and beyond. Extraordinary numbers. They're coming your way, and we know it, so how do we respond to that? Well, one thing we've been doing at the Open Data Institute is just trying to get nomenclature sorted out. This may seem very, very basic, but when you're dealing with policymakers and politicians and people in the C-suite, in the boardrooms, it's very important to get a simple framing of the landscape. And in the data landscape, there is huge confusion around the idea of what data is. To the extent at which, when we talk about open data, people seriously imagine that we're claiming that all data should be open. Your personal data, your medical records, nonsense. Okay, we recognize what we call the data spectrum. Think of it as a spectrum, like the electromagnetic spectrum. Starting at one side, we have closed data, which is available only internally, perhaps to an individual, perhaps to a particular group, perhaps to an organization, a department of state, or a particular business. That data may be small, medium, or large. It may relate to personal, commercial, or governmental information sets. As you move along this spectrum, the levels of access become different. So named access, individuals, groups of individuals can be permissioned in. There will be particular licenses around that type of data. And as we move to more obviously shared assets, whether that's for personal data for medical research or whether it's other sorts of case, we're moving along the spectrum. Public access, we're looking at situations that might require a license that limits the use to which that data could be put. It might be the Twitter feed, which although it's available in some sense, we can't, all of us, harvest all of it, even though we might like to and dearly love to, and do all the analytics in the world over it. We can get a representative sample of it. Some people have access to the so-called fire hose. And on the far right, there's the data that I believe is particularly important. It's data that anyone can use with an open license, unrestricted. So on this spectrum, stable use of terminology is important. And recognizing that there are legitimate interests that will shift data along that breadth of usage. I think it's also very important that we do see our open data as being something that's foundational. That's something on which other things are built, and that's what I want to emphasize and talk about now. Now, this is nothing new. We can go back to the 19th century, in fact, we can go back earlier, and see examples of data that was harvested, analyzed, and published out there for the public good, for public understanding. There's famously Snow's map on the right, which is the map he produced of the mortality rates in the cholera outbreak in the 19th century in London. Those black blocks on that piece of street layout there around Soho are the mortality rates in particular hospitals. And you can see the location of a pump on the intersection of Broad Street. That's where the deaths were highest. That was the first time people had understood that cholera was a waterborne disease. They thought it was carried in the air. This was a revolution in public health, as was Florence Nightingale's wonderful infodiagrams there, those so-called coxcomb diagrams that showed, in her parliamentary report on the Crimean War, showed how troops were dying through a year. It made people realize that most people didn't die on the battlefield. They died of insanitary conditions in hospitals, of failure of logistics. Really powerful insights. And when people say, well, what's the power of open data? It's not just about open data. It's really important to recognize that it's part of the story, but it's one part. And I often present this kind of cycle of licenses, open licenses, with open standards, with open data, encourages open participation, may sometimes be built on open source platforms. They tend to be particularly powerful. But the real magic here is open innovation. It's that you can get more eyeballs, more genius, more insight onto the data to do remarkable things with it. We have lots of examples of that. And when people say, well, the economics of this open data, it's just not believable, it's just not, where's the evidence? Just give them a history lesson. Here's a simple history lesson. It's a very interesting one. It's what happened on the Human Genome Project. Not so many decades ago, we were busy mapping the genome, the human genome, to understand what it consisted of. And you may remember there was a battle at the time between the public and private organizations. There was indeed an effort to patent the human genome, to put restrictive licenses on our insights from that structure. When it was published jointly in the two great scientific journals, Science and Nature, at that same time, Blair, who's looking a lot happier than he probably looks at the moment, and Clinton, always looks happy, they stood up, declared this extraordinary achievement, but they also did something else in the fullness of time. They struck down a set of practices which had led to companies that were publicly quoted on the NASDAQ, on the North American exchanges, stock exchanges, worth billions of dollars, companies who had been patenting snippets of the human gene. US Supreme Court ruled that the human genome cannot be patented. It declared it to be a public good, the information to be open. People said, disastrous, you're destroying value in the economy. Well, recently, a very authoritative economic study of the benefits to the American economy pointed out just about $1 trillion of economic impact by that act of liberation of the human genome. And if you look at the plethora, the wealth of innovation around, there's your evidence about why open data is so very powerful. There's many more. This kind of continues the health theme. Look what happened in the Ebola outbreak. There were many problems in that, but one of the things that was extraordinary was the collection and presentation of mortality data that got people to pay attention. And no less important was the information that was done and carried around the world on the genome for that particular infectious agent as we thought and sought to tackle the problem. Our own work in the UK, health has been at the heart of the open data movement. Releasing health data, it's challenging. It can sometimes be uncomfortable and controversial. But invariably, it leads to a discussion, a conversation. If the data is to be challenged, then let it be out there to be challenged. The data on the right there, on that roundel, actually, that's a representation of death rates in English hospitals, NHS hospitals, causes of morbidity, essentially. It was that data and data like it that pointed out the apparent fact that if you're admitted to an A&E at the weekend, you had a higher likelihood of dying. Now, that has been a very, very interestingly contested argument around whether that's true, what leads to it, is it really a ground fact? What is undeniable is it's changed the shift patterns at our A&E hospitals in this country. They looked at that data hard and practice began to change. In the same way that when they published the league tables of the infection rates in our hospitals, of hospital-acquired infections in particular, that league table of best and worst, over the 2 years from when that began to be published, we saw an 85% decrease in MRSA and C. difficile outbreaks. The data actually changes behavior. The stuff on the left there, that's if you want to see data that really does set you thinking, think about the policy context of the future, that's Lambeth, and those are instances of childhood obesity in 5 to 11 and 11 to 15-year-olds. We have this explosion of childhood obesity. It's a public health challenge. We need to know what the ground data is. This isn't new either. Of course, In a sense, health data and the fundamental facts of our mortality, when they began to be collected systematically, and you can go back to the outbreak of the plague in the 17th century, diseases and casualties. So it's fantastic to look at these early mortality rates and see what you could push off with if you were unlucky. Lethargy. I always thought lethargy is a form of, or the French pox, I'm not sure, it's all there. Cough and whooping cough. We recognize some of this stuff. Twisting of the gut, gripes, gravel, stones, and strangury. I mean, just fantastic terms. But they collected this data. They collected the data along with age, the age at which people were dying, and the birth records. That led effectively to the growth and emergence of an actuarial market, of the insurance market. Basic data collected at scale, made available, generated whole new classes of service. Well, in the UK, since about 2009, we have been explicitly, when Tim Berners-Lee and I were asked to help Gordon Brown's government begin the process of releasing data, there had been earlier work. There had been really interesting reviews in the earlier governments around the power of information, what might happen if we could have government driven by data. We began under successive governments, and this is to their credit, that under different political regimes, the appeal of open data has stayed steady. And I think it's because, as I'll say later, it has many benefits, not one single one, and different political persuasions can find appeal in different of those benefits. But we began to publish data in government on everything from spending to contracts to crime. This is the famous reported crime maps that the Home Office put out. We were assured by the police constables up and down the country that publishing this data would lead to a collapse of public confidence in policing. Actually, what it led to was the collapse of the server that hosted the data, because they'd never had so much interest in a government website. They had not stress tested it. It didn't lead to the collapse of house prices, which we were assured it would, because people would actually know whether there were lots of burglary in this or that area. It also led to a huge improvement in the quality of the data that was being reported, and it's been put to many ends, not least by Bobbies on the Beat, but also by activist groups, civil groups, and a whole range of other utilities. It isn't perfect. Not all data is mapped to the exact place of occurrence. For example, domestic violence is not so mapped. But there are intelligent decisions about what is and isn't released that has had real benefit. We move on to transport. Really a good example here. Many of you getting around this country, and particularly in London, Transport for London made all of its data freely and openly available. The ecosystem for travel apps in London is one of the best on the planet. Whether it's CityMapper or whatever you use, you can get around with an ease and an accuracy that was inconceivable, because Transport for London realized that they were not in the business of selling apps that they paid other people to build for their data that they limited out there and licensed. They just opened it up, and other people use that data, build those apps at no cost to London, and we now have a thriving ecosystem of apps that make their money through all sorts of the secondary, well-understood resources out there of advertising and API and special service layered on top of the data. Really good example. Open data in the environment. Lynn Truss at DEFRA has just committed and indeed released over 10,000 data sets in environment and agriculture. We have examples in cultural heritage. This is very interesting, actually, and as librarians, particularly interesting to many of you to reflect on the fact that much of the information held in libraries is locked under all sorts of perverse and bizarre copyright restrictions, even if you wanted to make it available. Some of the metadata standards in cultural heritage are actually locked down. So there's a lot to do here, but there is a real will to open up cultural heritage data, and there's good evidence. On the right there's the example of the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam, who were just fed up of all their wonderful old masters being badly ripped off and appearing on T-shirts and mugs and all the rest of it. They took a decision to just make highest resolution digital images just available for free. Didn't try to sell them or second guess, made it available for free, part of their public task. It's resulted in a fantastically rich range of businesses and services that use this high quality material with no worry about hindrance or kind of whether there might be some secondary charging. They just use it to everybody's benefit. They believe it's driven more people into the museum by having made that stuff widely and openly available. Research is getting there. Our own communities in scientific research getting there, and the university sector as well. And this has led to the government being top of the pops for a couple of years now in terms of this open data league table, always a dangerous place to be. It breeds a certain sense that the job is done, and as I will go on to point out, it is far from done. There is much left to do. What we've been doing at the Open Data Institute, which Tim and I set up 3.5 years ago now, is essentially trying to show how this movement, open data from the public and private sector, can actually generate a whole range of services. We don't just stay in the open end data end of the spectrum. We advise governments, we advise departments, local authorities, and indeed other organizations on the full range of the data spectrum, because very often the value of data is when you bring it into contact with open data. So closed data meets open data, for example. And what we've been doing at the ODI is essentially a number of things: training, key feature, everything from the use of licenses to the underlying publication technology, building a membership model, building a set of laboratories where people can test their ideas, communicating through our summit, incubating startups with an idea in this space. So we've been busy. We received originally a government grant to get started. We committed to matching it at the end of 5 years. We're matching it already. We think that in these areas, small investments can do a huge amount. In the world of the web, in the world of the amplification of one individual's ability through the web, you can do a great deal with lean resources. These are just a list of some of the startups who have been through our program. Here's a couple of examples. We're proud of this one. It's quite well known now, but I just restate it. This is the work of a small big data company, sounds odd, but a small startup in the area of big data. It took all the prescription data that is published every month. This is quite a success, actually. In NHS England, every physician, every GP has to publish every month all their prescribing data. That's extraordinary. Every drug they prescribe, not to who, but what it was and the amount, okay, and what for. That led to some extraordinary insights. One insight here, this is comparing statins. Statins are one class of drugs that are prescribed, comparing patented and white label or generic versions of statins. There's quite an ongoing discussion about how people prescribe, what prescribing behavior is. That just shows the variation in practice of practices that prescribe more generics than patented, or more patented than generics. What they uncovered was about, in 1 year, the potential for £200 million of savings had the generics been prescribed. £200 million for one class of drugs. Okay. This is another very interesting set of insights from another of our startups, Open Corporates, very much in the news again. Beneficial ownership. Panama Papers. Who owns what? And in collecting information about regulatory governance, in collecting information about the legal companies that exist in the UK, who they're owned by, we believe this is a fundamental principle of good governance. I suspect that many of the problems we've encountered in the various banking crises we've had, from LIBOR to the actual liability when banks failed in the 2008 crash would have been much more easily dealt with had we had the data. This is data that's collected, open data that's collected and integrated by Open Corporate. It's there at that website. There's one company they're looking at here. It's a whole. And what it's showing you, that network of connections, are all the interrelationships of subsidiaries owned by parent companies and companies within the Goldman Sachs portfolio of company types. And that large geographic object off the United States there, you might not recognize it. It looks like Antarctica might have slipped north a bit. That's the Cayman Islands, just represented in terms of the amount of beneficial ownership within that jurisdiction. These insights are powerful drivers of behavior and also services. So the benefits you get from open data, the reason I'm so passionate about it, they're political around transparency and accountability, as I've just said. But they can be economic. We can actually generate new businesses. We can show how innovation occurs. We can achieve efficiencies. They have a social benefit. They can highlight where disequalities exist or inequities. They're good for research. They're good for the data. Actually, the data once published, with all the eyeballs and participation you get on it, often becomes much better. I've got a few examples of that. And often, it's a fundamental resource for the media, for journalism, for informed journalism. Now, we'll come on to the issues about how we interpret it and whether that's good or bad shortly, as you'd expect. I'm a particular advocate of what we call linked data. The thing about linked data, without getting too technical and hairy about this, is that at heart, it's a very simple idea. It's this simple. If you can do nothing else, try and identify the objects and entities of interest in your data world with a URI, with a persistent identifier that you can put into a web browser and get something back. Whether that's a company, or a bus stop, or a contract, or an item of spend, give it an identifier that can be dereferenced and linked. If you do that, you can begin to build this extraordinary object we call the linked open data cloud. The linked open data cloud are collections of millions of hundreds of millions of facts connected using these simple publication standards. Simple publication standards are what made the web grow in the first place. Now, we're beginning to do that in the UK. We're beginning to do that because we're building what I like to think of as a new public good. In the 19th century and 18th century, we invested, we built public infrastructure. The sewers, water, delivery of our whole energy supply fabric. A national infrastructure around data would start with something like our geography. When we began this work, Tim and I, much of the Ordnance Survey's data was licensed. You had to pay to even use your postcode, okay? Well, at least half of their data is now fully openly available, and this is an example of some of it. This is the administrative geography data that the Ordnance Survey hosts. These are ways of referencing the identity and location of everything from schools to roads to bus stops to properties to companies. As you begin to build such an infrastructure, you're putting in an essential part of a 21st century's country's infrastructure, data about it, which anyone can use with confidence. You may have heard recently that the land registry is actually not going to be privatized now. We're rather pleased about that because our big fear around this is that your property data, the cadastral information about what title is, who owns it, would have become privatized. Okay. When we privatized the Royal Mail, we wrote to the Prime Minister and said, whatever you do, don't privatize the address file. The address file, the millions of addresses, of legal addresses in this country that identify the places we live. They privatized it. There's a problem. Okay, there's a single monopoly provider of this. It would be better if that were a public good, a public asset. They're looking at it again, being privatized. They're not looking to do this now with the property register. They haven't done it with Companies House, which now publishes lists of all the legal companies in the country as open data. Every company has one of those URIs to reference and access it. Once you have some of those, you can begin to link them together. So the real opportunity here is what we've always learnt in the digital age. It's the network effect. It's if I begin to have registers of contracts and spending and suppliers, or properties, companies in geography, or energy, tariffs and providers, or timetables in my public transport system and fares and performance, I can begin to interlink. This stuff should not be behind paywalls, because the value in this data is in its widest use. Now, when we've done this, we've heard any manner of excuses. We call them the data-hugging excuses. And you will hear this as you go around various places saying, what about making this data available? What about making it open? Well, it's wrong. And then people will tell us where it's wrong. Exactly, that would be quite useful to know. I can tell you that when the government published a thing called NAPTAN, which this was all the transport access points in the country, from airports to ports to railway stations to the humble bus stop. They weren't going to publish that because it was a national security issue about knowing where the bus stops were. they did publish it, and there are about 310,000 of them. How many of them do you think weren't where the government thought they were? The answer is 17,000 bus stops had gone missing or wandered across the road. And the fascinating thing about that example is that it took a crowdsourced effort and lots of crowdsourced eyeballs to fix up a data holding that was, well, it was wrong. It was only 7% wrong. Actually, for most data sets, that's not as bad as it might be. But these excuses can be turned on their head. People will draw superficial conclusions from the data without understanding the wide picture. Well, that happens all the time. The whole point about this is to be able to contest it. People construct league tables out of it. Yes. Generates more freedom of information requests. Actually, less, as far as we know. And so on. The thing is that it seems to me that this is suggesting that the more we do this, the more power we get. There are challenges. I just want to talk about a few of the challenges towards the end of the talk now and not get too misty-eyed about this. There's a very significant challenge when you try and integrate data together. And one of these just has to do with the fact that we can't ever stop as humans parsing the world up in different ways. And that applies to geography. This is our tortured geography. There are just a number of ways in which we partition the country up. What have we got? We've got 9 national trust areas, or we've got local government administrative authorities, or we've got HMRC areas, or we've got European regions, or we did have, or BBC regions, or NHS clinical sciences areas, or public utilities, or police areas. Every service and many, many of our governmental activities cross-cut, divide differently. That actually makes it quite challenging to integrate data together. It means that we need, actually, our position data at the finest level of detail we can, because then we can get inside it. It means that if we had a national infrastructure, like our legal addresses, like our land register, openly available, they become the objects that you use to identify where stuff is happening. Well, all this data requires a lot of storage and computation, that's true, but we've got to start to think about where the cost will fall on some of these provisionings.
You know, we take it as a fact that our taxes go towards supporting our road and highways network. Well, what about our data information architecture? I'm sure some of it will be privately provided, sure, but perhaps other stuff is a public task. Curation, how on earth do we keep this stuff secure into the future? These are actually challenges that you all face in many, many aspects of what you do in other contexts. I've talked about the quality issue. Actually, it was 18,000 errors. Look at that. It was 360,000 bus stops. But the point is made. The other one that I'd like to talk about is data literacy. And this is actually pretty material. I feel whatever way you fell in the referendum, that the use of data and information there really did live down to all of our expectations. There's this wonderful, I love this, my dog butt, here we go. You need a dashboard application to track your key metrics. That way you'll have more data to ignore when you make your decisions based on company politics. Will the data be accurate? Okay, let's pretend that matters. You know what? I think it does. And if we can't get to a position where we can have better discussions than just the bizarre shouting match we got into with the now disowned and we never said it really 350 million quid a week. Actually, Hedden Shah from the Royal Society of Statistics made a wonderful tweet. Should making false statements in a referendum be an electoral offence? And you go, whoa. Actually, there was an MP deselected in 2010 for making false claims around such data. Actually does apply, there is law, not been used in a referendum context before, but it's the general issue is how we should be held account for the claims we make around our data. Okay. And this isn't easy, I'm not pretending it's easy, because of course we do know that the whole issue around data literacy is to have the argument around, do I trust the data? Was it sampled correctly? Is it of any quality? Has it been subjected to critical challenge? New levels of data literacy call on a set of professionals to support the public and our leaders in that process. And I think many of those individuals are represented in the hall here today. So the opportunities for you as a group, I would submit, that everybody depends now on data, information, and knowledge, that there is a new essential skill around data literacy, and that your knowledge and insights, the methods and techniques that you have, are in some sense more important, more central, and more required than ever. From indexing to organizing the stuff, from the context to the to the sampling, to issues around anonymization, legitimate issues there. So for me, people working in your space are going to be essential to help us gather in the information in the first place, to publish, analyze, and interpret it, to make it business as normal. We can't collect everything. How will you make those judgments? What are the conditions under which you will feel comfortable to make the case for this data asset being made available for everybody, or this one being licensed differently? So I'd say that everyone is a data and information professional now. Let me just say one thing on the data information knowledge stuff. It's quite unfortunate that the term has come to be known as open data. I originally read philosophy and psychology as an undergraduate. I remember kind of back in the day of metaphysics and epistemology. You know, none of this stuff we publish out there is data, okay? Every piece of information, even in the data.gov.uk portals, is information. It's a number with a context, or a data cell with a context. So you know what it means. You know that 92 is either the number of cycle accidents, or a blood pressure, or a stock number. If you don't know that, you know nothing. If you didn't know that, you would have data. So actually, information, data equipped with meaning. Of course, everybody desires that next level up, which is knowledge, which is actionable information. How can I take the information I have and do something with it? In the case of a stock price, selling or buying, or in the case of a recorded number of bicycle accidents, actually putting in some traffic calming. What is the context in which I then take the information and use it? And I suppose I would just end with the following kind of observation. Later on today, interestingly, our timing is exquisite. Last July, the Chancellor and Minister of Finance in France, so George Osborne and Macron, commissioned myself and the head of data governance in the French government, Henri Vidier, to come up with a task force report on the opportunities for data innovation. The view being that both in France and the UK, there were examples of really vibrant data innovation cultures. So where could these two European countries collaborate and show the rest of Europe the way forward? Well, we're publishing that report this afternoon, just about the same time as Prime Minister's questions, I believe. No, just after, it turns out. And it'd be interesting to see who we actually deliver it to. But, in fact, well, it's delivered, to be fair. So it's delivered as was, but who will be acting on it will be interesting. But there, the whole tone of that report is around the power of data on innovation, infrastructure, and the urgent need for skills, trust, and empowerment around that information. And whatever the future, this is an area where we have to make common cause with those around us. Data, you might feel, might want it to respect jurisdictional and national boundaries. It can be made to, but often again, it has its most power if it's allowed to flow freely across the planet in the way that the web protocols were originally designed to work. So I feel very passionate that whatever our new political context, this agenda is one that we can take and really make work for us. And it's really important that we keep holding people's feet to the fire. The government's very proud of its achievements, rightly so, I think. Successive governments in the UK. But it's very easy to think it's a job done. I don't believe the fundamental cultural changes have been made to ensure that this is business as normal. That wherever you can, you think that the default is to publish your data as open unless there's a reason not to. That there's a default understanding of how a department or an organization can use data it itself generates to inform its own behavior. That a department or an organization can understand that making the data more widely available adds value not only to itself, but to the wider community. And that in many cases, this data should be open. That's a public good. And I love this quote. This is actually from Niels Bohr, writing in 1950. This is a very interesting example. This is a wildly, wildly controversial thing at the time. As one of the world's great physicists and scientists, he saw an absolute need for the great powers to share their knowledge on nuclear weapons. And this was at a time when that wasn't the case. That some countries had it and others didn't. He thought the only way to survive was a doctrine that we now call mutually assured destruction, that everybody had, well, not everybody exactly, but the knowledge is there, it's the capacity to do it that varies, of course, information about these terrible weapons of mass destruction. That asymmetry in this world was dangerous. But his much deeper view was that openness was the right way to build humane, equitable, and economically viable societies. There is the way in which you could bring civilization to a level of accommodation and cooperation. He believed that passionately, and he used as example, of course, those from the common foundations of science and learning in which he was involved. He wasn't interested in patenting the human genome, had he been alive at that time, any more than locking down the secrets of the periodic table would have made any kind of sense at all. So I leave you with that thought, and thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.